So I was wondering, has your attendance been better than usual lately?
Yeah.
Ours has been on Wednesday nights too, and I noticed that last time I was at White Sands Buddhist Center, there were probably a third more people there than usual. And I don't think this is because I've gotten better. I suspect that people, you know, if there's a silver lining to this cloud, I suspect that it's because when, you know, people are uniting in a shared purpose, and communities like this one, I think, pull together a little bit more closely, and I think that's a good thing. I'd prefer it be for other reasons, but a lot of people who talk to me about Buddhism seem to think that it's about spending a lot of time sitting alone and meditating. And that's understandable, because if you read about Buddhism, there's a lot of talk about monks in monasteries and going out in the forest to meditate under trees and that kind of thing. And a lot of Americans who come to Buddhism have already kind of shied away from the idea of organized religion, religion as a group activity. There's a term that we encounter once in a while, nightstand Buddhist, and this refers to people who like the Buddhist teachings, but they limit their Buddhism to the books on their nightstand. But even some of the people who come to Buddhist services mostly treat it as a solitary pursuit. And I've even had people tell me that they don't think Buddhism is a religion. And one of the reasons is that we don't insist on a belief in a deity. But this is really a mistaken idea. You know, Buddhism is not just a philosophy. It's a religion, but it's a religion that doesn't really stress a belief system. It emphasizes a system of practice. So when we become Buddhists, we don't expect to be saved by believing in a god. Instead, we go for refuge, and our refuge is our practice of Buddhism. And an awful lot of, as you know, a lot of you use feel drawn to Buddhism. And I suspect that a lot of this is because both emphasize practice over belief. And I've given this a lot of thought recently, and I think maybe UUs come together around a set of principles that don't define your beliefs as much as they define a way of sort of doing your spiritual relationship to the world. And I'd be interested in hearing later if that's your impression too. But that's kind of how I feel about Buddhism. So I'm going to talk a little bit today about the idea of community in the context of Buddhism, but hoping that maybe you'll get some ideas about ways that you can use the idea of spiritual community in your own life, and maybe as a resource as you try to cope with, as the reading that I used earlier said, the misguided associates and mistaken practices that are shaping these difficult times, and without losing your own mindfulness. So as I mentioned, when we become Buddhists, we don't consider ourselves saved. We go for refuge. And going for refuge means that we're directing the way we live toward what we call the three jewels. And the first jewel is the Buddha. We don't call on the Buddha for help the way you might call on a god for help. Going for refuge to the Buddha means that we're acknowledging that spiritual progress is possible, and that his example reflects what we want to achieve spiritually, and that we can live more authentically and more peacefully if we do the kind of things that he did. And the second jewel is the Dharma. And this refers to the teachings that the Buddha left, the guideposts that he laid down for us to follow on the path. But it also refers to the greater wisdom that comes from realizing for ourselves the fruits of this practice. And then the third jewel is the Sangha, the Buddhist community. And I think you could say that that part of the practice is what takes it from being a philosophy to a religion. So when the Buddha talked about Sangha back in, you know, in the early teachings, he talks about two specific things. The first is the Bhikkhu Sangha, which means the community of monks and nuns. And then there was the Arya Sangha, the community of Arahants. Arahants are those who realize the teachings completely for themselves and become completely liberated. So a lot of Buddhist traditions, mine included, it broadened this idea since the Buddha was alive. But those two aspects of community are still important. So when the Buddha was enlightened, he spent several weeks kind of enjoying this feeling of spiritual freedom and meditating. He wanted to make sure that he was fully understood what he had realized, that he hadn't missed anything, that he was really enlightened. And then he started wondering, should I try to share this or not? And at first he thought he wouldn't. He knew that what he had realized was deep and not easy to understand. And he saw that people in his time, much like many people in our time, were consumed by greed and anger. And he didn't think they'd be able to understand it. But then he said he felt compassion for all beings. And he said, I surveyed the world with the eye of an awakened one. I saw there were beings with little dust in their eyes and those with much. There were those with keen faculties and those with dull. Those with good attributes and those with bad. Those easy to teach and those hard. And he realized that people were like lotuses in a pond. Some lotuses stay down real close to the mud. They never get up very high off the floor of the pond. Some rise completely up to the surface of the water, but they never come out of it. They just make it to the top. And then some lotuses rise completely out of the water and open up and bloom in the sun, untouched by the mud from which they emerged. And he saw that people were like that. And so having realized that, he decided he was set up to teach. And once he was convinced that his teachings could help others, then he pretty deliberately and systematically created a means for his teachings' dissemination in a way that they would endure without him having to be present. So this first form of sangha, the bhikkhu sangha, consists of those who have heard the teachings and decided to devote themselves to practice, to teaching, and to maintaining monasteries and temples and places like that, so the path would be available to others. So when the Buddha was alive, that pretty much included mainly those who had left the household life to go off and ordain as monks and nuns, which was fitting in Indian society where it was accepted that people would do that, would decide that they were going to devote themselves to the religious life. As Buddhism expanded into other countries and other cultures, that changed a little bit. So now it includes ministers and lay teachers. None of the Buddha's teachings were written down for the first 600 years or so after his death. And so to be a member of the Sangha meant that you memorized and recited what the Buddha had said. So without the Bhikkhu Sangha, these teachings literally would not be available to us today. So when we go for refuge to the Sangha, part of this act includes this realization that what connects us, that this is what connects us to the Buddha and to the teachings. So when he started teaching, some of his students awakened very quickly. There were people who had been practicing a spiritual life for a long time, and they just needed a little gentle nudge in the right direction and they could become enlightened. And then there are others who heard the teachings, knew it would benefit them, and so they went to work practicing diligently, and they became completely liberated too. For example, he had a cousin named Ananda, who was known for having a highly developed memory. He could retain anything that he heard. And he was regularly at the Buddha's side. The Buddha was enlightened at age 35, and he taught until he was 80. So for that whole 45 years, Ananda was there much of the time. And so he remembered a lot of the teachings. So 3 months after the Buddha's death, all 499 arahants, all these the Arya Sangha, decided that they would assemble, compare notes, make sure that they all understood things properly and agree on what they were to teach. And they invited Ananda too, and this was the first Buddhist council. Well, Ananda was not yet enlightened. He had heard everything. But he was not, he hadn't practiced it to the point where he was freed. And so he didn't feel it was right to try to sit in on this council unless he became enlightened. So the evening before it was to begin, he sat and meditated all night long. And at sunrise, he still wasn't enlightened, and he gave decided he would lay down and take a nap and figure out what to do afterward. And as he put his head down, he was awakened. So this Arya Sangha is important because these are people who realize the fruits of the path for themselves. So we know because of their example that the path actually leads to freedom if we practice diligently. And there are meditations where you contemplate the Sangha, chanted in some traditions, because it's helpful to your practice to recognize and support the good that people like this have done. And by doing so, you gain a sense of the path and of its value to yourself and of the goal. So if you're not a Buddhist and you want to put these ideas to work for yourself, you might consider your personal Sangha to include people who have laid the foundation for the spiritual work that you're doing. There are people in every tradition who studied religion, founded churches, and that sort of thing. So, as part of your practice, it would be good to recognize the effort that they've made to make scriptures and places of worship available to you, and maintaining a sense of gratitude toward them and awareness of this value will help you stay centered in your own spirituality. And then there are those who have been where you want to go, people who have achieved the kind of spiritual freedom that you want. And so you can listen to their talks and read their books and so on. It's good to have respect and support for people like that, because that also helps you to recognize their value to your path. But to truly show respect to a master, you have to put the teachings into practice. You're not going to become a Zen master by reading about Zen masters or bowing to Zen masters. If you want to be a Zen master, you have to practice very diligently with guidance from someone who's been there. There's a famous Thai master, Ajahn Chah, who educated a lot of Americans and other Westerners who went to Thailand to study Buddhism. And often people would come to him with a lot of gratitude for what he had taught them, and they'd say, "Master, how could I possibly repay you for what you've given me?" And his answer was just practice. So this is what we mean really when we talk about respecting the Sangha. If we want to make progress, try to find someone who reflects where we want to go, what we want to achieve, and then follow their instructions. A lot of people in our society resist that idea. For a lot of us, I think, we think that if we have strong enough opinions, we don't really need expertise. And I don't think that serves us very well. So we're right, though, to be careful about following someone just because they're an authority. But we should also be very wary of our own opinions. If we're too dismissive of experience and knowledge, we can very well end up following leaders, spiritual or secular, who aren't really up to the task of leading. So I mentioned that in the contemporary Buddhist world, there's a kind of a broader sense of this idea of Sangha that's also useful. And I think for people in the UU community, this is probably the one that's the most helpful. So I'm going to read you what Thich Nhat Hanh said on this subject, because he expressed it very well. He says, "A Sangha is a community of friends practicing the Dharma together in order to bring about and maintain awareness. The essence of Sangha is awareness, understanding, acceptance, harmony, and love. When you don't see these in community, it's not a true Sangha. But when you find these elements are present, you know that you have the happiness and fortune of being in a real Sangha." So this broader Sangha is a group of people who share values and are willing to support one another on their spiritual goals. And the Buddha called such people spiritual friends, and he said that this was very important. In fact, there was an occasion where a young person came to him and asked him about friendship, and the Buddha cautioned that did the thing that somebody like me would do, stay away from the bad guys, don't get caught up with the unsavory companions, because that'll lead you to ruin. And then he said, but there's four kinds of friendship to nurture. He said, "These four should be understood as warm-hearted friends, one who is a helpmate, one who is the same in happiness and sorrow, one who gives good counsel, and one who sympathizes. These four kinds of friends the wise should behold and cherish devotedly. I think it's pretty safe to say that this is a sangha right here. I think, you know, from what I've seen, you meet those criteria. It's not a sangha so much because you have a corporate charter and a membership plan and all those kinds of things. Those things are useful, but they're basically management tools. You're a sangha because you're practicing spiritual friendship. And that includes things like listening to talks and singing together, because those are ways of learning and expressing your shared commitment, your shared values. But then actively practicing understanding, acceptance, harmony, and love, that's what makes us a real community. Practicing together and supporting one another as we weather difficult times, spiritual crises, is what makes Sangha a refuge. So we're part of a spiritual community. We don't have to go through whatever stress and difficulty life brings to us all by ourselves. We have one another to use and look to as examples of how to live better. And that's true friendship. The Buddha considered this sort of friendship critical to spiritual development. He was asked once, what's the prerequisite for developing the wings to awakening? And he said, having admirable people as friends, companions, and colleagues. That's the prerequisite. But it's not only important to have good spiritual friends, but also to be a good spiritual friend. I've told this story here before, but I like it, so I'm going to tell it again. So a Nakagawa Roshi was a Zen master who became well known throughout the world. He established Zen centers in a number of different countries. And there was a famous conversation between him and a student who was having trouble with his meditation practice. And the student came to him and said, Master, I'm so discouraged. I'm not sure I can keep going. What should I do? And the Roshi thought for a minute, and then he said, encourage others. If we try to pursue our spiritual path as a solitary endeavor, it's very easy to get wrapped up in our ego and our self-rating and stay trapped in our own cycles of delusion. But when we have the opportunity to look beyond ourselves to help others, then we find a much clearer direction. And in protecting our communities, we protect ourselves. And in protecting ourselves, we protect our communities. So it's when we practice as a community that a concept like Buddha and Dharma become a refuge rather than just an idea. The practice is our refuge when we put it into practice, when we develop wisdom and compassion and tranquility. And when we develop those qualities, we tend to spread them around. If we live wisely and lovingly, those around us become wiser and more loving. So when we're compassionate, that benefits both us and our friends. So some of you know, about 5 years ago, about this time, I was in India visiting the Buddhist pilgrimage sites. And I had kind of an interesting awakening to what the idea of Sangha meant while I was there. The first place we visited was Sarnath, where the Buddha gave his first sermon after his enlightenment. And there's this tall cylindrical stupa that marks the spot where he gave his first talk, outlining the Four Noble Truths and the Eightfold Path. And there's monastery ruins all around there. So I looked at the ruins, and then I went back toward the stupa, and there's a large open area where I was going to sit and meditate on this first teaching. And so I sat down in this grassy open space, closed my eyes. But as I sat there, I became aware of the other pilgrims that were around me. There was a group chanting in Korean. There was a group of Thai people chanting in Pali. People from the Himalayan countries walked around with prayer beads in their hands, chanting Om Mani Padme Hum. And there were a lot of people that I couldn't hear, but I knew they were sitting in the same grassy area that I was, meditating like I was. And I was at the spot where all this had started, where the first words were spoken that eventually led to the arisal of Thai Buddhism, Korean Buddhism, American Buddhism. There's a concept in Buddhism called stream entry. Means that you've practiced the teachings enough that your drops of merit, the results of your beneficial actions, have become a stream that lead inexorably toward freedom. And so I allowed this feeling of immersion in the Buddhist community around me. And I felt myself become a part of the stream of practice, leading inevitably toward the liberation of all beings. And at that moment, I realized that stream entry isn't about me entering my stream. There's no me, so there's no my stream. This is a process. It's a set of actions and activities. It's inseparable from everything else. So this is the ultimate meaning of Sangha. There's no spiritual awakening that doesn't include the understanding and realization of oneness. So our Sangha really is all beings, the world we live in. And our role in the Sangha is to be a spiritual friend to everyone and everything. So thank you. For